March 27th, Daily Video Bible Reading from the Net Bible, John chapter 18 from the New Testament. When he had said these things, Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley. There was an orchard there, and he and his disciples went into it. Now Judas, the one who betrayed him, knew the place too, because Jesus had met there many times with his disciples. So Judas obtained a squad of soldiers and some officers of the chief priests and Pharisees. They came to the orchard with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, because he knew everything that was going to happen to him, came and asked them, "Who are you looking for?" They replied, "Jesus the Nazarene." He told them, "I am he." Now Judas, the one who betrayed him, was standing there with them. So when Jesus said to them, "I am he," they retreated and fell to the ground. Then Jesus asked them again, "Who are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus the Nazarene." Jesus replied, "I told you that I am he. If you are looking for me, let these men go." He said this to fulfill the word he had spoken, "I have not lost a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, pulled it out and struck the high priest's slave, cutting off his right ear. Now the slave's name was Malchus. But Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?" Then the squad of soldiers, with their commanding officer and the officers of the Jewish leaders, arrested Jesus and tied him up. They brought him first to Annas, for he was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. Now it was Caiaphas who had advised the Jewish leaders that it was to their advantage that one man die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed them as they brought Jesus to Annas. Now the other disciple was acquainted with the high priest, and he went with Jesus into the high priest's courtyard. But Simon Peter was left standing outside by the door. So the other disciple, who was acquainted with the high priest, came out and spoke to the slave girl who watched the door, and brought Peter inside. The girl who was the doorkeeper said to Peter, "You're not one of this man's disciples too, are you?" He replied, "I am not." Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire they had made, warming themselves because it was cold. Peter also was standing with them, warming himself. While this was happening, the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus replied, "I have spoken publicly to the world. I always taught in the synagogues and in the temple courts where all the Jewish people assemble together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said. They know what I said." When Jesus had said this, one of the high priest officers who stood nearby struck him on the face and said, "Is that the way you answer the high priest?" Jesus replied, "If I have said something wrong, confirm what is wrong. But if I spoke correctly, why strike me?" Then Annas sent him, still tied up, to Caiaphas, the high priest. Meanwhile, Simon Peter was standing in the courtyard, warming himself. They said to him, "You aren't one of his disciples too, are you?" Peter denied it. "I am not." One of the high priest's slaves, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, said, "Did I not see you in the orchard with him?" Then Peter denied it again, and immediately a rooster crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the Roman governor's residence. Now it was very early morning. They did not go into the governor's residence so they would not be ceremonially defiled, but could eat the Passover meal. So Pilate came outside to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They replied, "If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate told them, "Take him yourselves and pass judgment on him according to your own law." The Jewish leaders replied, "We cannot legally put anyone to death." This happened to fulfill the word Jesus had spoken when he indicated what kind of death he was going to die. So Pilate went back into the governor's residence, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus replied, "Are you saying this on your own initiative, or have others told you about me?" Pilate answered, I am not a Jew, am I? Your own people and your chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done? Jesus replied, My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my servants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jewish authorities. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here. Then Pilate said, So you are a king? Jesus replied, You say that I am a king. For this reason I was born, and for this reason I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice. Pilate asked, What is truth? When he had said this, he went back outside to the Jewish leaders and announced, I find no basis for an accusation against him, but it is your custom that I release one prisoner for you at the Passover. So do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews? Then they shouted back, Not this man, but Barabbas. Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. God, when I read this account of what has happened after the Passover dinner that Jesus had with his disciples, if it wasn't for the seriousness and the awesomeness of why all this is happening, it would actually almost be a little bit comical. Here these soldiers come with weapons to contain Jesus Christ, not realizing that nothing in this entire world can contain him, control him. And then when he says, I am he, when they say, this is who we're looking for, even after having been crying in the garden, crying out to you, praying fervently to you, God, probably visibly upset, he still exuded this authority, this incredible power that could only come from being the Son of God. And they recognized it, and they retreated and fell to the ground. And then his disciples, acting more like bodyguards, try and take one of the priest slaves out. And Jesus, in all of this chaos and frustration, has to stop and heal the slave. And then we have the whole joke of the law, where the Jewish leaders are so fed up with Jesus and they want him dead, but they can't legally kill him, that they have to make up stories of why they want the Roman authorities to crucify him. And even the Roman authorities see through this. And Pilate, walking back and forth and back and forth between the Jewish leaders who were standing outside to not defile themselves because it was during Passover, and Jesus who's captive inside, and him having to go, okay, this is what they said. Who are you? Okay, going back out. Okay, he isn't breaking any rules here. I can't do anything. What do you want to do? Okay, Jesus, this is what they... And it goes on and continues to be this clash of egos, this clash of fearfulness, fear of having power taken away from them. And they are ready to kill your son for that. Even make up lies in order for it to happen. God, I love the timing of this. No matter what year people are listening to this video, it's going to be right around the time of Easter, right around the time of Holy Week, from Palm Sunday, when they rejoiced of your son coming into Jerusalem. The disciples thought that he was coming in, that your son was coming in to take over the throne, and they were about to be big deals in the Jerusalem world. Others thought he was simply there for Passover. But Jesus was focused on intently following the path that you'd ask him to walk for us, straight to the cross. This is such an amazing story of love, God. The love you have for us, where instead of killing all of us off, you replace our sin with your son's death. and our sins, our transgressions, are as white as snow because of this. This year, it happens to be right in the middle of Holy Week. We just celebrated Palm Sunday. We're going into Good Friday. And everything seems to be so much more intentional as to what really happened to Jesus and why he did this and the incredibleness of the love that you have for us. You know, I'm a little bit baffled that if somebody died for us, meaning one of our friends died for us, pushed us out of the way and they got killed by a car, gave up a part of themselves and ended up dying on the operating table so we could live, there wouldn't be a day go by, an hour go by, that we wouldn't think of the person who gave up their life for us. Yet why do we so often forget that your son did this? And that you gave up your son for us? Why do we go hours, sometimes days, perhaps weeks or months, forgetting the incredible sacrifice that you have done for us? I sometimes think it's really smart what the Jewish leaders did, writing bits and pieces of the Bible all over and putting them on their arm and putting them on their forehead in the little boxes. Although, for them, that turned into a sin thing because they wanted people to know they were so holy. But God, I just wish I had a way of intentionally always keeping you right in front of me. I seem to allow the day's issues or the day's problems or the day's drama to intercede on all of the things that I should be focusing on. God, I don't want my life to look like all of this, all this chaos and these lies and these accusations and this fear and this frustration that was happening this week from all these different people. Even betrayal. I don't want that in my life. I want thankfulness. I want humility. I want to be in awe every day of what you've done for us. God, I want this story to just take over my heart and take over my life so that nothing can sidetrack me off of what you've called me to do here. It's not to get wrapped up in situations or problems or people, not in the way that the world does. You've put me here on earth to glorify you. And that first and foremost needs to be in my mind every single moment. I can't just say thank you for replacing your son and your son's life with my sin. It seems very shallow. But I can work on with you every day making my life count for your son's death and doing good in this world so that others know about you. Thank you for the act of love that you gave to every single one of us. In your son's name we pray. Amen.